Okay, now this is Boots Mayberry, Walter Mayberry from Harrison, Arkansas. And he's going to give us a little oral history of his time in the military during World War II.
Well, I was still in high school when I became 18, and they had lowered the draft age to 18. So when my friends and I graduated, we graduated in May. I was going to have to go back to summer school, so I didn't really graduate, but I was taken into the Army, U.S. Army, on July the 16th, 1943, and while at Camp Robinson, Arkansas, they put out a directive saying they needed young men between the ages of 18 and 21 who had scored high on the Army classification test to join the Army Air Corps. The Air Corps then was just a branch of the Army. We were flying soldiers. So I didn't much want to stay in the infantry, and I volunteered for the Air Corps. And the Army Air Corps didn't become Air Force until 1948. So anyhow, I left Camp Robinson, Arkansas, and was sent to Amarillo, Texas, to the Amarillo Army Airfield, they called them, where I went 9 weeks of basic training. And following that, I went to gunnery school at Kingman, Arizona.
Is that why you're such a good shot today?
Yeah. Well, I was already a pretty good shot. Kids in those days, in the 30s, grew up almost with a rifle of some kind.
Right.
We were already good shots, but they took note of that, and the technical schools were filled up with bombardiers, pilots, co-pilots, navigators. So they sent the rest of us to gunnery school. And I had such experience with guns that they sent me to aircraft armorer school at Denver, Colorado, where I learned how to repair and maintain the turrets and 50 caliber machine guns was our basic weapon that we used in flight in those days.
And then where did you go from Denver?
I left Denver, and we went to Sioux City, Iowa. I'm shortening this a bit to take where the various crew members, some other technical schools, were eventually brought together. Your pilot, co-pilot, navigator, radio operator, and gunners all were joined together. We meshed together as a team and were sent to Lincoln, Nebraska to await orders to go overseas. We didn't know which theater we were going to at that time. I might mention that. This was in about November of 44. We were in a movie one night, and they flashed a direction on the screen for all combat crews to report to the flight line. We'd already been packed up and ready to go, but we found out that we had been assigned to a new B-17G aircraft. It was loaded down with things to transport to the ETO. We found out later the
What's the ETO?
The European Theater of Operations. Okay. We had no idea where we was going until when we took off in a snowstorm and headed northeast. We passed Chicago at night, and our navigator was from Chicago, and he said, "All right, men, look down and see the last of my hometown for a time. We're headed to the northeast and probably to the European Theater of Operation." So then we knew that we were on the right way to what they call the sort of the breakfast of champions. They were taking the best of the Air Corps had to offer to send to fight the German Luftwaffe and then the bombardment of Germany.
Now, so you left Chicago, and did you stop along the way?
We stopped. The first stop was at Dow Field, Bangor, Maine, where was your last
last U.S.
Yeah,
soil
in the United States. We flew on up north Atlantic alone, ferrying this new aircraft, and our thoughts were probably varied, I'm sure, about whether or not we would ever set foot back on the continental United States or not, but we weren't afraid. We were looking forward to getting and doing our part since we had trained together quite a while. But we made an overnight trip from kind of shorten the distance over the North Atlantic. We landed at Newfoundland, Greenland, Iceland, and on the way to Iceland, we saw what appeared to be the first friendly aircraft that came up to greet us to see what we were doing. It was attached to probably Iceland, and it was a P-47 Thunderbolt. Painted all white. I recall it visibly, and it had a huge polar bear head painted on the front. And our 50 calibers were all loaded for action, and we were considered in a war zone. So when this aircraft approached, he didn't come in head on. He slid in from the side to be sure that there were no gunners there with itchy triggers, itchy fingers. So we proceeded on after he identified us, and eventually we landed in Valley, Wales, at an RAF aerodrome.
In Wales?
In Wales. It's right on a little peninsula called Holyhead.
Yeah.
In Wales, and that's where we touched down on the United Kingdom soil.
I think you told me once that you you flew over Ireland and never seen anything so green in your life.
Ireland, and when I looked down through all of the bleakness of the ice and all of that, I saw this little small emerald thing, and I called the navigator, and I said, "What is that green spot down there?" And he said, "That's the Emerald Isle." Oh. And it really was that way, because it stood out amid a bleak a ground scene.
So, but you landed in Wales, and that's where you stayed for a while.
We landed there, yeah.
Okay, now where'd you go from Wales?
We went all across England from the west side to over in the east side of England, where we learned that we were going to be attached to the 388th Bomb Group.
And you went by train?
We went by train and made several stops at various places until we arrived at Stone, England, which was near a village called Stoke-on-Trent, where famous China cups teaware was made.
Did you know when you got on the train where you were going?
No, we learned when we got to this point, Stone, England, the pilot told us that we'd be assigned to this group in the 388th 560th Squadron.
Now, what is the story? What is this story about you being AWOL?
We had stopped and were waiting to change trains, and my radio operator and I went into the tea shop and met our first English young lady who served us tea, and we got engrossed in talking with her, and the troop train left. So we were AWOL, our first day in England, you might say. The radio operator asked me, he said, "Boots, what do you think we should do?" And I said, well, let's go back in and have another cup of tea and talk about it. And then we talked to the train master, and he told us, well, buy yourself a couple of tickets and go to Stone, England, and they'll be looking for you, I'm sure. So we met our crew back at Stone, England, and our pilot, when he saw us coming in, I didn't know if you were going to make it or not, Mayberry.
Okay. So were you a troublemaker?
Oh, well, I was just, I'd never been away from home a whole lot. None of the other guys had.
How old were you?
Quite a great adventure.
How old were you?
I was 19 at that time.
Okay. So Boots, when you got settled in the base, what was it like there?
Well,
what did you do?
The base was pretty well dispersed around the English countryside. From the operational part where the planes, bombs, and runway was in a separate location from where crews were kept, sort of isolated because the airfields had been attacked by German fighters earlier in the war. And they didn't want all, you know, us all in one place where we could have been pretty much wiped out, planes and men. So our Quonset huts where we lived, the 560th Squadron, was well situated away from where we actually flew. The mess halls and all were some miles away, so the first things crews would do would try to find them a bicycle. Crews that had finished their missions would leave their bikes, and we all had a bike where we rode a mile or so to the mess hall. And then we started being indoctrinated by flight conditions in England. The weather was pretty bad, so our crews took several training missions around over England and out in the friendly parts of the channel called the Wash, which was a training area where we flew. And from we didn't fly very high, and we could see the old castles and various things of early England, which was quite interesting to me because I was pretty much an Anglophile, I guess you'd say.
Yeah.
I loved things doing.
How long did this training go on?
We got into England in the first parts of December. I might add that around the 4th or 5th. And we didn't fly our first mission until the latter part of December. So the
what year was it? This was 1944. What year was it?
44.
Okay.
December of 44.
Okay.
The pilots, the navigators, radio operators all went to a training phase over there. The gunners went to one before we could actually start flying the combat mission.
Okay. Tell me about your first mission out of England over to Germany.
The first mission was a disaster for us in a way. We were to bomb Ludwigshafen, Germany, and we had gotten off the base and were well on the way into Germany when our oxygen system failed, and the pilot had to drop down below the bombing altitude, and eventually the flight commander issued him an order to return to base, which was quite scary because we had to reverse course and come back to England alone without any fighter escort. And we had to drop down below where we could remove our oxygen mask. Had we been able to drop our bomb load on Germany itself and return, we would have gotten credit for the first mission. But for some reason or other, unknown to me, the pilot decided to return to the base with 5,000 pounds of live bombs in the bomb base, which is only about 8 feet from my position.
Oh.
And to land the aircraft in uncertain type weather with 5,000 pounds of explosive around it. It'll get you gray hair in a hurry. But we made it back, and consequently, we didn't get credit for that first mission, but that was our start.
So, Boots, you're flying B-17s, and you told me once that there are lots of things to be concerned about because besides just the Germans. So what exactly did you have to contend with?
Wintertime flying in England during the war was a dangerous thing. You had many things to contend with besides the German Air Force. Our equipment was the best at the time, the oxygen equipment, the heated suits. We didn't wear those leather fur-collared jackets like they had early in the war. We wore a heated suit. Each man had a small rheostat and plug where you could hook up your heated equipment for your own self. And your oxygen, we were all individually connected with these things. But the altitude we flew at was somewhere around 5 miles up, 27 to 28,000. Wintertime, it would get to be 40, 50 below zero. You touched nothing metal, or you couldn't get loose from it. Well, your oxygen, when you became excited and talked, moisture would collect in your hose, and you'd have to stop what you were doing and crunch the ice and keep breathing. Your electrical suit was in the danger of shorting out. If you perspired a whole lot, which happened when you got in combat conditions, the suit would be known to short out. And you couldn't live less maybe 7 or 8 minutes without oxygen. And without your heated unit, your limbs would freeze. And there was no turning back. For one man out of a flight of 700 or 800 bombers for one man to come home. So your life was in peril long before you got attacked by the German fighters and the anti-aircraft fire from the ground.
And that's just getting there. You got to return afterwards.
Yes, that's what happened to our first mission.
So Boots, tell me about your missions after your first mission.
After the first one, we got pretty well to working as a team. Things began to fall together like it had all been planned for us to become one man, so to speak. We worked as a good team. The number of missions each crew was to fly in those days was 25. And toward the end of that era, they raised them to 30. So we wondered whether or not we were going to be able to get through all of that if they kept raising them, whether we were all going to be dead by that. But anyhow, we did fly 10 missions. And they were all long. They were all to eastern part of Germany. At that time, we were going the full extent that a B-17 could fly, and the escort could go with us all the way. But they were all to the eastern front, pretty much. So some of them are vividly etched in mind, like the day we flew to Cologne Cathedral, which was very ancient city, the outstanding site from 5 miles up was Cologne Cathedral, which stood on the banks of the Rhine River, and there was a major railroad bridge across the Rhine in front of Cologne Cathedral, and we were bombing in that area for communications and transportation and things of that nature. And our aiming point was Cologne Cathedral, which means you use it to bomb in another area, sort of a triangulation thing, which the bombardier took care of, but we weren't after cathedrals or churches or places of that nature. Yeah, I might mention that these bombing missions were huge things. There were like 800 or 900, sometimes 1,000 bombers on one raid, along with 500 fighter planes. Each squadron, like ours, could put up maybe 30 planes from each group, and there were groups from all over Eastern England, and we flew in boxes of 3 aircraft, a lead ship and 2 wingmen in 30 plane squadrons. And the bombardier, we had narrowed it down, not a bombardier for each ship, but for each 3 airplanes. The other 2 were considered toggleers. When your lead bombardier dropped his load, the toggleers merely pressed a button and dropped there. If the bombardier was off, yours were off also. But it was a complete saturation from 900 bombers, which carried about 5,000 pounds of bombs each, which was quite a load. We went to the major cities in Germany, were pretty well beat up by the time we were there. Went to Cologne, to Frankfurt on the Main, to some cities which I had only read about in history, being places of ancient kings and queens and so on. Augsburg, different places where I only had read about, but the big ones was to come, which was Berlin. We all wanted to go to what we call Big B, and we got our chance to go there in February of 45, and that was quite a lengthy flight, which was pretty much the endurance of what we could do in those days.
So leading, and all the missions leading up to your last mission, did you have to fire, you're a waste gunner, right?
Yeah.
So did you have to fire very often on the enemy?
I fired a few times, but I might add that fighter planes weren't our real bother at the time we were flying. Our escort was pretty much the master of the skies over Germany, but our
That was P-51s, right?
P-51 Mustang. They had wing tanks that they could fly in and out with the groups. If they got into combat, they had to drop their wing tanks so they could be more maneuverable. But we didn't worry a whole lot about fighters. Our constant fear was the German anti-aircraft batteries, 88 and 120 millimeter cannons, which could reach our altitude of 5 miles up, usually around 30,000 feet.
And
but they, when we were flying our last mission, we were considered in the worst position you can get in, which is called Taily and Charlie, or Purple Heart Corner. You were the last plane to go over the targets. And to contend with the flak somewhat, we carried what we call chaff, which is like a bundle of metallic tinsel that you decorate your Christmas trees with. The first planes we would go in, they would throw out literally thousands of these metallic strips, which was supposed to throw off the radar of the ground guns firing at you. It didn't help the ones dropping it, but it did help the ones coming over later somewhat, not really a whole lot.
Okay. This is February 20th, 2012, 67 years ago, was your last mission.
Yeah.
And I know it's one that you'll never forget. Tell me about your crew members that were on the mission. I think you've got a list of them.
And it was sort of a cruddy day when we left England on this morning. We thought we'd have to bomb 10 tents, but later on in the flight, it grew visual all the way. We could see everything, and they could see us. But along on that final journey, February 20th, 1945, was a group of young people that had survived the depressions. We were all what I think was prepared for what we were going through in World War II, but I'd just like to give them credit, as we were a team, and I'm sure they would have things to say that I don't go into, that they would like to be here too. But there are, the pilot was Joseph D. Ellis from Colorado, William Seed from Washington, Indiana, the navigator George Bartnick from Chicago, whom I mentioned earlier, the engineer gunner was Walter Paskin from Illinois, radio operator Mark Galsch, waist gunner Walter Mayberry, ball turret gunner Donald D. Carl from Mobile, Alabama, Wayne S. Elkin, who was a toggleer and gunner from Hot Springs, Arkansas, Glenn S. Wright from Utah, the youngest man on the crew, 17, the one that I had to literally boot out of the airplane. But I...
So, Boots, okay, that was your crew. Tell me what it was like once you were airborne and headed for your target, and where was your target?
As I mentioned, the weather was bad at the base, but when we got over the top of the clouds, it was all beautiful. We finally, after the planes were scattered out pretty much, we assembled in our formation, leveled off, and were off to Germany. We were flying visual, and we could see all over southern Germany, and they could see us as well. Mm-hmm. And the flight into the target was uneventful. We had no fighters. We were all pretty well looking forward to getting there and getting home. But as we approached the outskirts of Nuremberg, Germany, which was our target, the anti-aircraft fire from the ground, which we all was afraid of. You couldn't fight it. You could shoot back at fighters, but it was intense. And they threw up a box barrage over the target. By this time, they knew where we were headed. So all they had to do was get your plot your altitude and throw up this huge black cloud of metallic splinters. We called them little black flowers that bloomed in the sky.
Oh my goodness.
And you could hear when one burst under you, the plane would rock, holes would open up in your the aluminum portion of your plane. We were lined up for the target, which was some sort of munitions or a plant, I think, maybe a ball bearing factory. The bomb doors were open. Later on, our pilot told me, he said, I could see a line of flak in front of us. Two bursts hit close. The third burst hit the right wing on the inboard engine, and it caught fire. And this is only 7 or 8 feet from our bomb load of 5,000 pounds. Bomb doors were open. We were ready to drop. But the plane on fire, and all of your gasoline is in tanks in the wings. The pilot kept us on course, until we dropped our bombs on a target with the plane on fire.
Oh, goodness.
With a full load of guys aboard wanting to get out. The minute the bombs were dropped, the co-pilot says to the pilot, "The right wing looks as if a giant scythe has cut it loose at the fuselage and it's blazing."
So the co-pilot looked out his right-hand side and saw that the wing had been severely damaged. And what happened next?
We were still on the bomb run and made the drop on the target with the plane on fire. And then the captain took over again and gave the verbal command to bail out, as well as ringing an alarm signal that went off. And but at that time, he thought he could dive the airplane and slip out the fire. That's the reason he didn't give the command to bail out. He thought he slipped the fire out and put it into a dive from 28,000, and it was 13,000 before he pulled it out. It was out for a time, then relit. And then it was then that he gave the command to abandon the ship. And everything's at that time was kind of in a melee. The tail gunner couldn't get his hatch open. What was happening up front was beyond my knowledge. They probably all had gone out, and the pilot, I think, had set the plane on autopilot in order for them to bail out. I kicked the escape hatch open, and there was just a wall of smoke and flame going by. But this time I saw the tail gunner come up, and he couldn't get his hatch open. And I waited for him to come up. He was a 17-year-old guy. He moved down into the hatch and saw the smoke and flame and was afraid to go. And I'm afraid that it's gonna blow. So I put a big boot between his shoulder blades and actually kicked him out. And I went out through the smoke and flame right behind him. And we hadn't been told much about how to use a parachute. We didn't think we'd ever have to use them. When we checked them out from the supply sergeant, he would say, "Well, just pull this little red handle if you need to open it." He said, "If it doesn't work, bring it back and I'll give you another one." That's black humor. So I was sort of wanting to know if mine was going to open. You were supposed to spall a certain dive to put them out. That we left the airplane, I didn't know how many had gone out, but I pushed the tail gunner out, bailed out, pulled my ripcord right away. The little pilot chute comes out and just flaps in my face, and I started pulling on it to open the thing up. And when I couldn't tell where I was in relation to the ground, but my head was toward the ground, my feet up. When the chute opened, it popped me around and consequently jerked my neck, breaking two or three vertebrae in the upper part of my neck, and I couldn't use my hands to guide the chute, so it just had to drift. I didn't know later that I had actually broken my neck until we were liberated some months later, and the flight surgeon wanted to know how I'd broken my neck, but I received no treatment on the ground. We get back to the fall from I was probably 13,000 feet when the chute opened, when I bailed out. And it was in the clear. I saw the tail gunner shoot for momentarily. Then things were happening on the ground. I was picking up ground fire. I had a P-51 Mustang saw me, and he came to circle around and round my chute to see that nothing else happened to me as far as any fighter attacks or that sort of thing. But their time is, they have a certain time that they have to return to their base or they're out of fuel. So the last time around, I could see him real close. I could see him above his face mat, and he saluted. And that's either the soldier's farewell or hello. But he probably meant it as a farewell. But anyhow, I wondered many times if he survived. Mm-hmm. When I got closer to the ground, I began to pick up ground fire, small calibers going through the canopy. I could hear them whistling by and going through. And eventually I hit the ground in a large open field that had been prepared for spring plowing. And there were many people gathered around watching me. As I mentioned before, the day was fair and clear as today, and they could see me all over South Germany.
So
it was a miracle that I ever got hit the ground in one piece.
Yeah, and you said coming down there was a lot of flak, and what kind of stuff did you pass coming down?
Well, it was 88s, and one they had a 120 millimeter that could fire, you know, up 5 miles and be very accurate, as we found out. That's what brought us down. And the descent through all the wreckage that was falling was terrifying. There were bombs still being dropped from the aircraft above, and anti-aircraft fire still shooting at them. And there I am in a little silk canopy, 13,000 feet up, and it was just clear as a bell. I could see all of them gathered in a big field. I couldn't guide my chute. At the end of the field was a high-powered line on these big pylons, and I was afraid my chute would drift and hang into these high-powered lines. And I was watching it, and then eventually seeing all those people who were waiting to greet me into the Deutschland, and things began to pop as soon as I hit. I didn't have any chance of escape. There I was with arms that were useless. I couldn't get out of my chute, but they helped me do that in a very meaningful way. They checked me over for firearms and such as that. They were pretty rough in doing that. There were old men, women, young boys. They're all civilians, and that was the dread of flight crews of being falling into the hands of civilians instead of being captured by the military. But I eventually was taken and put into a little local jail and locked up until they could move me out of there that night to a nearby German aerodrome, where I spent some time before going to the Stalag.
So, as you told me once before, that you were in the field and you were really scared for what the farmers might do, and then what happened?
I was taken to the local jail.
By the army?
A squad of German soldiers in a little jeep-type mobile thing drove. They saw me too, and they came up and took me from the civilians and put me in a local jail and locked it up good. I was glad that they did. And they left, and I spent the afternoon in there. They sent a couple of German police in there who searched me and took our escape kits and searched to see if I had any firearms. But each crew member was given an escape kit that had maps in it, had compasses, had sort of a brief survival things. But they took those away from me. And I waited there till dark because they didn't like to move around in the daylight on account of American fighters. So they came after dark in an old wood-burning bus. It had a boiler on the back and was full of wood chips that they could shovel in and run this bus by steam. And already aboard was one of the crew members, a fellow that I didn't mention, John Strossland, was a radar operator who had been on that final mission with us to check out some special equipment. He wasn't normally a flyer, but they sent him along on that last mission to check this radar. Well, John Strossland was already captured and was on this bus, and they took me and him and put me in a German aerodrome that was nearby. They took us and put us in cells that were normally used for their own personnel. So I stayed there 10 days in solitary until they could move me out to an interrogation camp where they could find out exactly who I was, because we told nothing but name, rank, and serial number.
Okay, now. Yeah, so after the aerodrome, how did you get to the next place? Where did they send you next?
After the 10-day solitary, they sent us to Frankfurt, Germany, where it was a large interrogation camp that we called a sweat box, where they kept you in a series of interrogations until they could find out or determine who you were, what you knew, and so on and so forth.
And they sent you by cattle car, is that right?
Yeah, well, I made a number of trips around Germany from one camp to another. This is late in the war, and the Allies are advancing from the west, and the Russians from the east. And they're closing in on pincers. And the reason they didn't let POWs go, or our supreme commanders had placed Germany under an unconditional surrender. They couldn't surrender at all, except on our term. So they were holding us somewhat as hostages to try to sue for better peace, which didn't turn about. So they didn't let us go. They just kept shuffling us around from one camp to another, till we all ended up in one huge camp at a place called Moosburg, Germany, Stalag 7A. And in that camp was supposed to be anywhere from 80 to 90,000 Allied prisoners of war, all in one little small acreage of shelters. Most of them were ramshackle barracks used in the first war. A lot of us slept outside. Some were in tents. And this was still winter time in Germany. It was in April, although there was still snow and sleet and all that around at different times. So some of us were actually sleeping outside. But to get to these places, sometimes we had to walk maybe 80, 90 miles. Sometimes we were all herded into cattle cars, 40 or 50 in one little car, a train load of prisoners, where in the cars there was no sanitation, and maybe a little bucket. Maybe half of us had to stand while the other half sat down, and then after a time we would reverse. They would stand and the rest of us could sit. And we were subjected to air raids by the American Air Force during the daytime. We were bombed, the engines were shot up, and we had to get out and find a ditch to get in to escape the American fighters.
So let's talk about the last Stalag you were in and the liberation. Tell me all about that. I'm sure that was a bright day. In fact, that would be 4 months from now.
Yeah, it was in April. While I was in Moosburg, 7A, on April the 12th, I remember vividly, because the Germans over their loudspeaker had told us, said, "Your president, FDR, is dead." Your great leader is no longer with you. And we didn't believe them. We thought they were trying to lower our already low morale, but it was sometime later we learned that our great wartime president, Roosevelt, had died. He didn't get to see the end of his great efforts and during that period. So it was close to Easter. About this time of year, Shrove Tuesday, Ash Wednesday, all those things, I was in the camp at Moosburg, Germany, which was 20 miles from Munich and only 8 kilometers from Dachau, the extermination camp, where in our camp we were on some low days when winds and the humidity was low. We would get the smoke from the chimneys at Dachau. It would blow over our camp. We were liberated on Sunday, just after Easter, 29th of April, 1945. We had learned 2 days before that the Allies were getting close. They said, don't try to escape. It'll be just a matter of a few hours. And on a Saturday night before that Sunday, we could hear German armor retreating through the town. Sunday morning, I was awakened by a small engine on a small plane. I looked out from where I was sleeping in a small ramshackle barrack. I saw overhead a small tailor craft type aircraft. We call them Grasshopper.
Right.
An Army Air Force observation plane was hovering over the camp. The stars under it and all that. I could see him, and he was directing anti-aircraft fire, or not anti-aircraft, but artillery fire was firing over the camp at the German armor retreating, and some of the of it was falling out into the camp, so we took cover. The battle went on to liberate the camp for a number of hours, and we finally learned that the 99th Infantry and the 14th Armored Division had taken the camp. Part of General Patton's 3rd Army had liberated the camp on that day.
You were there and Liberation Day came?
Yeah, 29th of April. The first American I saw was in a Sherman tank. He drove through on a German guardhouse on top, knocked it down, came through the barbed wire, pushed up the turret, stuck his head out. He's a young fellow about my age. He's probably 19, 20. He didn't have on a tanker's helmet. He had on an old Western calf rover, dirty style Stetson hat rolled up that had been through many a rodeo, and a red bandana around him. Now, he was one of the liberators in the 14th Armored Division. Said, howdy, we howdy. And he kept going. They had to go continue after the Germans who were retreating. They had no food except what was with them in there. We were 80,000 prisoners waiting for something else. We were 600 miles in Germany. Americans had no place to go. The roads were clogged with millions of homeless, and we thought it would be endanger ourselves to try to get out and try to get our way back to our bases. So we waited there, the orders to stay where we were till something could happen to get us out of there. In the meantime, I got to see General Patton came through the camp 2 days after it was liberated. He and his staff marched in to see the conditions that existed there. And I did get to see General in person. And we were there several days before they could make arrangements to fly us out to France, where we were given new uniforms and baths and re-equipped, and most of all given physical examinations and good food and a lot of milkshakes. And when I was examined by the flight surgeon. I had probably lost maybe 30 or 35 pounds. I was down to just over 100 pounds. I never was a big fella, but we did get new uniforms and showers, and it was so wonderful to see white bread again. It was just like angel food cake. We were liberated, and on that day, there's a huge flagpole on the front gate of Stalag 7A with a swastika on it. And we were all watching. Each guy in the camp had made himself a small flag of his nation out of whatever scrap he could do. Belgium, Holland, so on, had their own little flag. But we watched the swastika come down. And in its place, a star and stripe went up 600 miles in Germany. All of these 50,000 waving their little flags. Hooray, it was just indescribable, the joy that went on about being free again.
So, of course, this was just the end of the war with Germany. The war with Japan was still going strong in the Pacific. So how did you get back to the U.S. and what happened there?
We were flown out of Germany to France near Le Havre and waited several days for transportation to the United States. We were put on a ship named the William T. Barry, a Liberty ship, in a convoy that took off sometime in June to come to New York. But we were in a convoy because German submarine wolf packs were still operating in the North Atlantic. So we had Canadian destroyers on all sides of the convoy, and we had to travel at the rate of the slowest ship, which was about 8 or 9 knots. Consequently, it took us several weeks to get from Le Havre, France, to New York Harbor, where we eventually landed sometime in late June and were sent across by ferry to New Jersey side, to Camp Kilmer. And on the way across, we could see the Statue of Liberty in the harbor there, which caused quite a bit of celebrating too. Sure. But we were in Camp Kilmer several days. It was there that I got to talk to my mother in Pine Bluff by phone, who had only received a missing in action report. She didn't know that I was alive.
Till you called her.
My older brother, Edward, was in the D-Day landings, and he was in the ground forces who fought. He fought all the way across Germany in the field artillery as a forward observer. He was the same rank as I was, a staff sergeant. When I called my mother from Camp Kilmer, I could hear the operator saying, when I heard my mother answer the phone, she said, I have a call from Staff Sergeant Mayberry. And I heard my mother say, which one? So Bud was still over there. And I heard the operator say, it's Walter. And then there was a silence.
Oh, yeah. I could see that that had
to be. None of us spoke. And it was that was the first time she knew I was alive.
And you stayed in Pine Bluff? Yeah. You went to Pine Bluff on leave?
I made it to Camp Kilmer. We stayed 2 or 3 days. We're sent by train to Fort Smith, to Camp Chaffee. Mm-hmm. Stayed a couple of days and given a 60-day furlough to go. I went back home to Pine Bluff and stayed there a while to go back to get into the other part. We were training to fly on B-29s, but that's another part of the story. Yeah, that was an emotional time.
Yeah.
They knew that I was still alive, and all my grandparents and brothers and sisters and father, I'm sure, all rejoicing.
And so they sent you to Fort Chaffee for a few days, and then you were home.
Yeah, I was home for, I think, 30 or 60 days, I don't remember, and then had orders to report to Miami Beach, Florida for relocation. And I went to Miami, and while I was there in August of 1945, getting ready to fly on B-29s to bomb Japan, the war in Japan still going on, the B-17s weren't capable of the overwater distance in the Pacific area, so we were training on B-29. And while we were doing all this, they dropped the first bomb on Hiroshima, August the 9th, the 6th, I think it was, 1945, and several days later, they dropped one on August the 9th on Nagasaki, and the war ended with Japan while I was in Miami Beach, and quite a celebration, needless to say, went on in Miami that August of 45 when the war ended. That's where I was, and I stayed in Miami a few weeks, and being a former prisoner of war, you could choose any air base in the United States that you wanted to be, you wanted to go to be stationed at. So I chose one near my hometown at Stuttgart Army Air Base, only 40 miles from Pine Bluff, when I could have picked anyone in the United States. I'm over in Stuttgart in the middle of the rice field and the mosquitoes. But I wanted to be close because I didn't know when we would be released from Army service. I had some time to pull up while we were all getting relocated, and just, you know. But while I was stationed at Stuttgart, I came home quite frequently to see my family and friends. I got a notice one day to report to Barksdale Field, Louisiana, for discharge. And this was in December of 1945, which was quite the month that I remember, because our great leader, George Patton, General Patton, died that year, month, 45, from an accident in France. But I went to Barksdale, and just exactly, you know, when you enlisted, they said the duration plus 6 months. That's what it turned out to be. I went in July 16th, I think it was, 43, and got out November of the same day, exactly duration plus 6 months. So I got an honorable discharge and came back home after almost 3 years, from 18 to 21, my age time. And that was pretty much the age of all the defenders of freedom in those years.